Thank you very much for the invitation. It's a really great pleasure to be here and to share with you some thoughts on nanoparticles imaging in biology. It's really hard to come after the previous speaker was shown such wonderful imaging. And a few other considerations about science, which you will see what I mean by this in a few minutes. So yes, Liverpool and Tel Aviv have at least one common point, which is that they have a waterfront. So this one is the one from Liverpool. And I had the pleasure of cycling the waterfront in Tel Aviv this morning to come here. So why imaging? I think we've had already very, very nice examples today, and I'm sure in the previous days, of why imaging is really important. And I just show you here two different examples, which are not based on nanoparticles at all. So the key reason why imaging is important is because biological systems are dynamic, and they are spatially heterogeneous. So in my talk, I'm talking about imaging imaging of biological systems, and nanoparticles are one option to image biological systems, but I'll develop this a little bit later on. So I'll just tell you a little bit more about these pictures which I've shown on the slides here. The one on the left is a really interesting, quite newly accessible technology, which is called light sheet microscopy. So I don't think anyone has spoken about light sheet microscopy yet. At least not today. So it's a really, really interesting technique which kind of bridges the gap between single cell imaging, where you have a very high level of details and so on, up to model systems where you have several cells, several hundreds of cells, several thousands of cells, but you can still, as you can see here in this example of development of a shrimp, follow all the different cells, their movements, and so on in real time. And if anyone is interested in this, I'm happy to discuss a bit more about this. And this is just another example showing a particle protein shuttling in and out of the nucleus. And so the point of this is really that if you want to understand these systems, you need to have, okay? Maybe I will. You need to have this spatial and temporal resolution, which spans from the few nanometer up to several cells, several millimeters, and so on. And of course, animal imaging as well. So maybe another reason why imaging is nice pictures, nice movies, inspiring, artistic, let's say, visions. And this one comes from a picture show on the journal Cell, which has a really very, very nice galleries of lots of different imaging. So why nanoparticles? Because I think that's a legitimate question here, because all these very, very nice examples which I've shown you before were not with nanoparticles. None of these were using nanoparticles. So there are lots of tools which are available to microscopists, to biologists, to look at their biological systems, and they don't necessarily require nanoparticles. So I just wanted to ask you, what do you think is the most important discovery in biological imaging, in the past, let's say, 50 years? Anyone wants to risk a guess? Well, or an opinion, actually, because we don't have to agree on this. No? Yes? Something? Try something? I want you to engage and have a debate. You will see this is the most, I'll have much more controversial questions later on, so you have to warm up to this. Confocal microscopy, I think that's on the kind of, I'm not sure what would be the date actually for confocal microscopy. I mean, it's a kind of development. I would say GFP, and I think GFP, so the green fluorescent protein, which comes from this jellyfish, and for which these three guys got the Nobel Prize in 2008, I think GFP has had enormous impact on biology, and you can't actually even overestimate that impact. I think probably most of the talks in the last 3 days have shown some pictures of cells, of proteins which were labeled with GFP or with other fluorescent proteins which have been developed from GFP. The key thing, one of the key things anyway about this approach is the capability to encode your probe within the gene itself. So you make this fusion protein, you're interested in a certain protein, the cell or the biological system is going to make it for you, the protein of interest with your label attached to it. This seems now so obvious that, you know, I feel somewhat, it's a bit strange to explain this, but actually, of course, this is a major difference between GFP and any nanoparticle probe that we're going to make. So if we are going to use nanoparticles for imaging, we'll have this problem of attaching and recognizing our biological object of interest, which is something that, in the case of GFP, the biology is doing it for us. So if we say, why nanoparticles, why inorganic nanoparticles in particular for imaging, I think we have to find these reasons, these properties, that make these objects actually interesting and relevant for imaging. So again, I need your help to populate that slide, which is blank, and which I don't have any. There is no animation hidden in that slide. So if you don't put the if you don't help me putting the information, it will remain black, basically. So thankfully, I have a pen, so I can actually use it, not to write on the screen, but there is a bit of space here which I can use. So I'm focusing in here on inorganic nanoparticles for imaging. I mean, what sort of properties do you think are useful, could be used for biological imaging?
Inert.
Sorry?
Inert.
Inert, yeah. So that's a inert. So that's kind of a more kind of chemical property, I guess.
Contrast.
So contrast, let's say. So let's try to push that a little bit more. So what would be the source of contrast or density? We're speaking. Oh, here, sorry. Sorry. The atomic number. So that would be like the electron density. Yeah? Electron density.
They can have special properties like detecting copper 64 on TC111, which doesn't have that can introduce really bulging atoms to a whole system that you can look for in a different spectrum of electron waves.
So I didn't quite get that, sorry.
If you have an inorganic system,
okay,
it probably has different spectrum.
Different spectrum, so optical properties.
Optical
properties, yeah. So optical properties. So maybe we can take some examples there. Yes.
Have to be safe,
okay. So that's another interesting point. So inert, safe. I mean, these are two are related, but not exactly the same. So maybe, okay, there's probably a size range that, you know, we don't want to have something which is enormous by comparison to the system we want to look at. So there are some issues there. So basically, I would say, we are going to develop that a bit during the talk, of course, but basically we have some chemical properties.
This is not degradable.
Yeah, maybe some physical properties and some biological properties, which may be related to size or so on. So let's focus on, this I will develop a little bit more with examples later on, because of course, depending if you're talking about, let's say, gold nanoparticles, carbon nanotubes, quantum dots, or so on, the specific properties will be different. And I think it's a legitimate question to ask for each of these whether it makes any sense at all to use them for biological imaging or not. And I think the answer is probably nuanced depending on the material, depending on what you want to look at. So I just want to discuss briefly this question of imaging of nanoparticles versus imaging with nanoparticles. It's a good thing that the previous speaker, who gave a really excellent talk, I really liked his talk, has actually left the room, because in the first column here, I use silicon as a bad example of, as you will see. So I'm just looking at a couple of scenario there. So let's say I've seen that at the conference, and it was a completely different group, and I haven't put name here because it doesn't actually matter. But let's say you have someone who doesn't know anything about biology, worked with, let's say, silicon, and mill this material, find its fluorescent, and then put these things into cells. Do biological imaging, publish some papers. This is imaging of nanoparticles. The selling message is, we've got these new materials, they're great, and we can do imaging. This will never do anything else than actually add to the piles of papers, because there is no particular, imaging things in itself is not, there is no actually reason why you would do that. You don't, this part, if the point is just to see something, there are many other ways of seeing some things. So that's scenario two is what many of the talks we've heard, and the previous talk in particular, is about. So people are making nanoformulations for various reasons, for nanomedicine basically, and they need to visualize it, and we've seen some really nice examples of this. And so they incorporate tracers and do their imaging. We've seen some example with nuclear imaging, with nuclear tracers, and that's a very, very powerful approach, as well as fluorescence, of course. And then the third scenario is maybe where I am a bit closer in terms of the science I do, but I'm not actually focusing that talk particularly on what we are doing in Liverpool, but where scientists are interested in the biological problem, in particular protein localization dynamics or something, and then they want to use, they don't actually want to use nanoparticles. They want to solve their biological questions, and the question then is, could nanoparticles provide any advantage at all? And I would say it sometimes makes sense and sometimes not. So that's a black slide. And it's to remind me that the next slide is going to be a bit difficult. So so that's the next slide without any transition. And this is something that on my title slides I've put a few other considerations about science. I thought you are mostly an assembly of young people, and we have to face this problem. That we have a reproducibility problem, that this has made the news, in particular about cancer treatment, where companies, for example, have tried to reproduce many different studies and found that many were not reproducible. And some of this also relates to nanoscience and to a particular controversy where I'm involved in. This is, I think, a serious problem where the reasons for this problem are multiple, and we have to address this. So I want to ask this question: what should you do when you disagree with a paper or when you find an error in a paper? So that's actually a pretty simple question, but what would you do? What most people do anyway?
Ignore it.
Sorry?
Ignore it.
Ignore it. That's one possibility.
Or you can contact the author.
Contact the author.
Ask for something.
Ask for something, yeah. Contact the author. Ignore it. That's two possibilities. Anyone wants to... I think that's what most people would do. They would ignore it. And the result of ignoring it is this. I'll let you read the first two. I think it's a really good one. Actually, I didn't make that. There is a link there. This is an enormous waste, because there is so much wrong data which is out there, and basically people trying to build on this wrong data. So, many PhD students here, postdocs, maybe they spend a few months on a paper trying to do something with it and it didn't work, then they have to, and then they ignore it. But then that means there is a few other PhD students somewhere else who are doing the same thing, and you can see the considerable waste of resources that is involved in this process. So I would say, you know, if you've done lots of work and you show that something doesn't work, then that's definitely data and you should definitely publish it. And I think nowadays there are avenues to do this. There are ways of doing this, of at least sharing this kind of data with the community. And I think one point which you will see hopefully in a few minutes why this is something that, apart from the controversy I'm involved in, why I think that's quite relevant to our discussions. So some steps we can all take: forget the impact factor, so stop publishing in Nature, Dan, and engage in post-publication peer review. So one of the reasons why I've become interested in these discussions is, do nanoparticles cross biological barriers, and in particular, do nanoparticles diffuse through cell membranes? And of course, that's really important for nanomedicine, so for many of the talks we've heard today and yesterday and so on. And so I think that it's unlikely that, well, first I want to make a comment about nanoparticles, because of course nanoparticles are extremely diverse, and so their properties will be very diverse as well. And making general statements about nanoparticles is a little bit like making general statements about molecules. But actually about molecules, we can say with certainty that some small molecules do cross membranes. I would say that for nanoparticles, it's much more questionable. However, if you look at the literature, every nanoparticle that you can imagine has been reported to cross a membrane. I think the evidence is actually very weak for most of these papers. And when I say diffuse through the membrane, I'm not talking about, you know, a massive aggregate of particles coming on the cell, disrupting the cell and so on, or release of some molecules which have a biological effect. This has been demonstrated. But actually, a nanoparticle diffusing through a membrane remains a challenge. So I think this question there is a bit of a vexed question. If you look at the literature, you will find everything on its contrary. And it would be really nice if people would engage more in this discussion openly so that we can arrive as a community to some sort of a consensus. And we have tools for that. We don't have, well, we can discuss here, that's one step. We can discuss through papers, but that takes years. But we can also use more modern ways of communication. And it's quite remarkable that scientists who, you know, are the leading edge of progress and so on are quite slow at taking up modern technologies of communication in terms of having these kind of debates. So I would say join the discussion, and there are various ways of doing that, including blogs and Twitter and so on. So in the remaining part of my talk, I will be maybe a little bit less controversial and focus on a few examples of nanoparticles used for imaging. So starting from the materials, then looking at properties and whether you know, these really make them an attractive proposition in terms of imaging of biological systems, and then maybe also some application potential. So maybe quantum dots are I think they are quite an interesting example of materials, because fluorescence is certainly, in terms of imaging of cells, is certainly the most developed techniques, the most standard techniques that you have in any significant biological laboratory. You have access to confocal microscopy and so on. So if you come up with a material which has extremely good fluorescent properties, as quantum dots have, you would think that this would be the ideal one. You know, if there is one which is going to make a big difference to biology, to biological imaging, at least at the cellular level, in cell biology, you think it would be quantum dots. And that movie is one example from now 11 years ago, yes, that's right, nearly 11 years ago, of one paper looking at single molecule diffusion with quantum dots, single receptor diffusion with quantum dots. That's a, that was published in Science. That's been cited something like 2,000 times. So it was one of the first examples of this kind of experiments of single particle tracking with quantum dots. And because they are very bright, so the fluorescence comes from the confinement of electron hole pairs in these semiconductor materials. And because they are very bright, you can follow single particles with essentially you know, a pretty standard epifluorescence microscope and look at these trajectories and so on and so forth. Okay, this one needs to be started. And I don't know if you see something, because the light is not ideal. Maybe you see something. So these particles are blinking. And do you see the blinking? Just about. It won't work because it's embedded in the slide. So it's fine. I mean, so you'll have to believe me that that on that little movie, or maybe I can just temporarily. Yeah, so you can see it a bit better now, yeah?
Yeah.
Right, so I've been told to keep the light on because of the filming, so I put it back now, but hopefully you've seen this little blinking of the quantum dots. So this is a particular properties of quantum dots. It's got some good points and some bad points. So one bad point is that if you're trying to track a single particle and it's only emitting light part of the time, it's quite hard. You know, if you've got two quantum dots particularly, and if they are starting to come closer to each other and then one turns off, then you don't know which one went where and so on. So it's a bit of a disadvantage in that sense. And people have done a lot of work on trying to get quantum dots which do not blink. But I've put a minus or a plus here about blinking, because one interesting development in microscopy in the last few years has been the development of super resolution techniques. And these techniques all rely on fluorophores being on or off at different times, essentially. So in terms of super resolution, blinking can actually be an advantage, and this is something that we are trying to use anyway, and that's been proposed and that we are trying to use. Okay, so let's see. So do quantum dots have an impact on biological imaging? Just done this little search, literature search, quantum dot and single molecule. You can see the number of publications. It's kind of stabilized in the last few years. And I haven't put the same thing for GFP, but I can tell you that, that the unit on the left scale would not be the same. But the other thing is that actually a lot of these papers are not about biology. So they are still, like, 10 years after that first paper I showed, a lot of these papers are still essentially material science papers, basically people making new materials and saying that they can be used in biology and things like this. So there are a couple of nice biology papers, but a lot of it is not translated to real biology. So I think there is some impact, but it's pretty limited, in fact, even now that it's it should be quite mature. Superparamagnetic iron oxide nanoparticles, this has been already presented very nicely by the previous speaker and also by other speaker. I just want to mention this thing, because that's one problem with MRI is not very, very sensitive. And you've got problems of signal to noise. But this is very impressive. I don't work for Bruker. I don't get anything out of this. But so this is a. Let's show this in a. Right, can you see something?
Yes,
just about. This is real-time imaging of superparamagnetic iron oxide nanoparticles using this technique of MPI, and So this is fundamentally different in terms of detection principle to MRI. MRI detect the protons of the surrounding water, which are disturbed by, I mean, the relaxation of these protons, which are disturbed by the presence of the nanoparticles. Here, it's direct imaging of the presence of the nanoparticle. If you don't have any nanoparticles, you don't have any signal. So this is a really interesting technology. Unfortunately, for the moment, their technique is only MPI, which means that you only see the nanoparticles. You don't have a background image of the actual organs. They have a development instrument which combines MRI and MPI, but they don't sell it yet. I think even the MPI has only been launched less than a year ago, and it's probably several millions, and you need a dedicated building, essentially. But it's certainly a very interesting development for application of nanoparticles in imaging. So gold nanoparticles, that's a lot of what I do. So one thing I haven't really discussed in all of these cases, but I think it's quite familiar to anyone in this audience anyway, is that all of these applications of nanomaterials require a lot of engineering of the shell. So you basically always need to functionalize your nanoparticles to attach your molecules of interest and so on. So there are various reasons why gold nanoparticles are interesting, and I'll expand on that in a minute. But first, I have to ask you another question, which is, and Elena, stop smiling now, which is, when was this electron microscopy pictures taken, do you think? So that's an electron microscopy picture of gold nanoparticles inside HeLa cells. When?
1967.
Okay, we've got one guess from Professor Dampier. Don't be in. Okay.
I'm guessing.
Yeah. Sorry? 70 something.
No, it's in the 50s or below.
Yeah, it's 57. It's 57. Yes, it's 57. So. Okay, you've got Dan at the back who knows everything, but usually when I ask this question to an audience at a conference, people say 80s, 90s. Last time I did that, actually, in Lille, the first two answers were like 2000, 90s, and then someone said 70s, and the entire room burst laughing. So it's interesting that gold nanoparticles have been used as a contrast agent in biology for over 60 years, right? 60 years, yeah? And the reason is precisely that they are electron dense, so they are a good contrast agent for electron microscopy. And in this case, that particular paper was, in fact, about looking at... So they were not called nanoparticles, of course, they were called colloidal gold. In this case, they were looking at trafficking. They were trying to understand endocytosis and so on. So in terms of properties, we've got the fact that they are electron dense. We've got the one advantage of gold nanoparticles over many of other nanoparticles is that the functionalization is extremely easy. Even I can do it because you've got the style chemistry. And then in terms of optical properties, you've got a large scattering and absorption cross-section, which means that you can detect single nanoparticles by, in the case of scattering, by dark field microscopy, although that has some other limitations, and absorption by a technique called photothermal microscopy, which I will explain a little bit more in detail in a second. And then you've got these other properties which can be used for sensing. So one of the papers, probably the most cited papers in nanoparticles, are these papers on the aggregation of gold nanoparticles with complementary DNA. So you have a change from red to blue when the nanoparticles aggregate. So the nanoparticles of gold are red because of the free oscillation of the oscillation of free electrons, sorry, which is called plasma. And then this distance-dependent plasma coupling and distance-dependent fluorescence quenching. I'm going to explain this a little bit more into detail. So just to say one thing, a couple of things about the kind of things we do in Liverpool. So we've worked a lot on the functionalizing nanoparticles with peptides and kind of tuning the surface properties of these gold nanoparticles with peptides. We've designed peptides which form self-assembling monolayers, and we're trying to understand the structure of these peptide layers. using various tools, and then we use this mixer, Fasel and Monaghan strings, to also include functional groups so we can prepare some assemblies and so on. So here you can see the dispersed nanoparticles, which are red, and the aggregated nanoparticles, which are blue. So just by looking at the color of your solution, you have an information about the nanoscale organization of this material, which is a really nice thing. So to say also one word or two about photothermal microscopy, because it's a quite interesting technique that has been developed originally by the group of Brian Lunis in Bordeaux, in France, but we have also built one in Liverpool. And the principle is, so gold nanoparticles are not fluorescent, so these, but they have very strong absorbance cross-section and scattering, but for the smaller particles, let's say below 20 nanometer, the key thing is absorption, the absorption cross-section, is becoming much larger than the scattering cross-section. So the way this technique works is that you have a heating beam, which is in the green, where you have maximum absorbance of these nanoparticles. So if you have a nanoparticle in your focal volume here, these nanoparticles will be transformed into a heat source. So you will have a change of temperature around that nanoparticle, and you detect this change of temperature and therefore of refractive index using this this red beam here. And then you also actually use some tricks. So in fact, you don't use a continuous green beam, you use a modulated green beam. And then you block the green beam and you detect the signal in the red channel. And you're looking at the modulation that was present in the green. So that's why you get such a very high sensitivity. So you can detect, they've demonstrated detection of 1.4 nanometer gold nanoparticles. The change of temperature is relatively small. I mean, you can burn down your cells if you want to, but you don't need that to detect a signal. And you don't have any photo bleaching or blinking, so you can follow single particles for basically as long as you want. And that's an example of an application. This is an image taken with our microscope, where you can see single particles with a really, really high signal-to-noise ratio. Actually, you don't actually see the noise on this image. But these are 8 nanometer gold nanoparticle with a far-field technique. And then, because you can follow single particles for a long time, you can look at tracks, so you can look at diffusion of these single particles at the surface of the cell. In this case, the particles were actually labeled with a single FGF protein, and they are looking at diffusion of this protein in the at the surface of the cell. So now I'm moving to two different properties, and I use two papers to illustrate, and also to link. I'll also link this to some previous discussion. So. How many of you have heard about these nanoflares? Anyone? Yes, one?
This is for DNA.
This is for detection of mRNA inside the cell.
No, I'm saying the strands of RNA.
This is Chad Merkin's work. Yeah, this is a paper from Chad Merkin. You can see that here. Yeah. So this is Chad Merkin's work on detection of mRNA. So the reason I'm showing that paper, I think it's a really interesting work. And maybe I should have said, so I'm a physicist by training, but I'm based in the Biological Sciences Institute. And so I interact with biologists every day who are interested in imaging, and in imaging their transcription factor and so on, and signaling and so on. So, yeah, I know. So when they saw this kind of paper, they thought, great, you know, we can use that to look at mRNA inside the cell, and there is no good way of doing this at the moment. So if nanoparticles can do that, then this should have a really big impact, right? This was in 2007, and I'm going to tell you a couple of anecdotes there. So the way this is supposed to work is that these particles are engineered, so the physical principle behind the sensor here is that these things here, I don't know if you can see where I point there is a blue circle, a blue disk, yeah? This is a fluorophore, and when the nanoflare is intact, this fluorophore is in close proximity to the gold nanoparticle, So the fluorophore is quenched. Basically, when you excite the fluorophore, instead of emitting fluorescence, the energy is transferred to the gold particle and dissipates as heat. So essentially, this is the gold nanoparticle is acting as a traditional fluorescence quencher here. Then you add the mRNA, you release that strand, and because it's now far from the nanoparticle, you have fluorescence. So this is a really interesting system. Now, of course, if you want to do this inside cells, you'd need that to be in the cytosol. Because if it's in the endosomes, the mRNA are not supposed to be in the endosomes. So it shouldn't work, except if it goes outside of the endosomes. Now, this is not discussed at all in the first papers, probably even the first few years' papers. And in fact, when I was at a conference a couple of years after this paper, and I discussed with one student working on this in Chad Merkin's group at a poster session, she didn't know what an endosome was. So then a couple years later, I heard Chad Merkin himself presenting this work at the Gordon Research Conference on Noble Metal Nanoparticles, and his talk was a lot about endosomes, in fact. Well, not a lot about endosomes, but basically highlighting that this was a really a big problem, and that if any young people in the room wanted to solve it, they would do a great thing for the field, which I think is both true but very highly challenging. Now, I don't know. I have some colleagues who are, I haven't tried to reproduce these experiments. I have some colleagues who are developing similar systems, and the indication I have is that basically it seems to work, but the fluorescence comes from endosomes, so I don't understand how that can be. Maybe the mRNA do access the endosome. You know, maybe there is some interesting biology there that will come out of this. You know, maybe it works, but it works because of things that we don't understand at all, and maybe we will understand them one day. The good thing, another good thing about this is that they have now developed a company based on this, so you can buy it. And I think we will see very quickly, you know, if in 10 years' time there is 1,000 papers using these tools, then it means it works. If not, we will know. This is another paper which I highlight for the same similar reason. I mean, there is no company, and I think this will probably not be reproduced, but it's another by another really leading group. This is work from Alizato's group, where they prepared these crown nanoparticles. So that's also very, very nice architecture. And because you have these particles which are in close proximity, you have plasmon coupling. So instead of having the band here, you can barely see it, but basically that's where the absorbance of the isolated nanoparticles should be. And then when they are into these crown assemblies, you shift into the red, basically. Now, the nice thing is that then you can incorporate linkers that you can break, and you can use that to detect, and you can do it at a single particle level. So potentially, you could use that in live cells, looking at proteases in live cell at a single enzyme activity, single enzyme activity. But of course, this suffers from the same difficulty that if you want to do this outside of the endosome, then you need to get it outside of the endosome first, and that's something which remains difficult. So I'm going to shift now from gold nanoparticles to gold nanorods, and also to shift scale, because in fact the reason why we are interested in gold nanorods, and these are slides from Joanne and Oyani, the reason why we are interested in gold nanorods is for cell tracking, and in this case the properties we are interested are related to the photoacoustic effect. So that's an even older paper than the one I showed you before. That's 1880, and it's really quite nice. So Professor Bell announced the fact that thin disks of very many different substances emitted sounds when exposed to the action of a rapidly interrupted beam of sunlight. So the experiment described in that 1880 paper is basically you focus light on a piece of absorbing material, and you suddenly interrupt this light, and you will have emission of a sound, and this is because you have basically changed in the expansion of the material. So you can use that principle for imaging in animal using a technique called multispectral optical tomography. And the principle of the technique, these slides are from this company, Aviv Medical, in Germany. And you basically irradiate your particles with laser pulses, and if you, and then you absorb anything which absorbs in these wavelengths will have thermoelastic expansion, and you can detect this by ultrasound, using ultrasound detectors. And then you have to reconstruct all of this, and you can use absorbers. You can scan your wavelengths at different wavelengths in the infrared, and therefore you can deconvolute the signal coming from different absorbers, which is a very, very interesting aspect of this technique, and which is one reason why it's relevant for gold nanorods. So these are just to show you why gold nanorods. So what's called the optical window, where you have maximum transparency of the tissue, is here between 700 and 900. And by tuning the aspect ratio of your gold nanorods, you can basically be wherever you want in that window. So these are spectra from the work of Joanne, and you can see that by tuning the aspect ratio between 3 and 4, basically you can change your plasmon band between 700 and 800. And I haven't included this data in the presentation, but actually in the last couple of weeks he's done some experiments in phantoms using two quantum dots of gold nanorods of different aspect ratio, and the deconvolution software can really pick up very nicely the two populations. So you can imagine using that for multispectral for detecting multiple labels in the same animals. So so one problem is, so we won't use, I mean, I haven't explained why we want to do this, but so we want to do this for cell tracking, and in particular we have a big program in Liverpool related to regenerative medicine and stem cells, and one of the big questions is where do stem cells go following injection. And so this technique, if we label the cells first with the gold nanorods, is a very interesting technique to look at biodistribution, and it's very fast, as I will show you on the last slide. So it's got very good dynamic resolution. But one problem is that we're going to label the cells with these rods, and they're going to enter into bioendocytosis. They will be into endosomes, and they will aggregate, or at least be in close proximity, which means plasmon coupling between these rods, which means broadening of this nice sharp peak in the infrared. So one way that we are hoping to mitigate for this effect is to use rods which are protected by a layer of silica, so that even if they clump together, they stay at a relative distance that we can control, so that they don't have so much plasmon coupling, and we keep the shape of the peak not too much changed. And these are silica-coated gold nanorods that have been made also in Liverpool in the last few weeks. So to finish my talk and leave some time for questions, and also not delay the coffee break, I just show you some other data that we have acquired recently. This time, real-time imaging in a mouse model, but not with nanoparticles, with a dye which clears through the kidney. And I don't know if you've seen, maybe I'll play it again from the start. So you can see this. So this is an experiment where we inject this dye. How's it called? Through the tail vein injection, and then a few seconds after the injection, you see the accumulation and then clearance in the kidney. So we are interested in this because we have a model of kidney damage and kidney regeneration with stem cells, and so that's one way of looking at the health of the kidney and whether the kidney is regenerating, is to look at clearance. So with this last example of imaging, which was not with nanoparticle, I'm closing my talk, and I'd be happy to take questions on whatever aspects of my presentation. Thank you.
Questions?
Or comments? You're talking about this? No, that's not for in vivo application. That's not my work. Yeah, that's a paper from the group of Alivisatos, and they use. I don't think this has been really followed up much. I mean, they make this architecture, as you can see here, of gold particle. I guess you. I'm trying to think whether there is any way you could actually use that in vivo. I mean, I don't think so. Anyway, in that paper, they used it in vitro in the sense of even cell-free, just having these... Sorry, say again?
It was just demonstrating the system.
Yeah, and then the... Yes, the idea here is to use the shift of the plasmon band when you disassociate the this construct of this chrome construct. The idea here is to use the shift of plasmon band that you have to detect the activity of the enzyme, which in this case is a protease. Yes, they've used it inside cells as well, but not in vivo. No, I don't think so. There is a paper which uses a similar principle, I mean, actually, in a way, well, let's say a sort of a mix between the two papers here that I have highlighted. So they use an infrared dye, which is attached to a nanoparticle via a peptide linker, which can be cleaved by a protease. And that was used in vivo. They use an infrared dye for that purpose, and to look at some particular protease involved in inflammation or something like this. This is quite a nice paper.